Be a DLI ambassador for computer vision, natural language processing, and multiple data types. He is also a consultant for artificial intelligence, data science, and personal learning. He obtained his bachelor's and master's degree in computer science from Bishop Heber College, India in 2010 and 2012. Dr. Sridhar completed his doctoral degree in the Department of Computer Science, Bishop Heber College, India. He has worked as a postdoctoral fellow in Bennett University from June 2017 to December 2018. He also sought more R&D engagements in capacity as a research officer in the Multimedia University, Malaysia, where he was actively involved in the development of first successful sentiment analysis and visualization tool for the Malay language for the telecommunication company Telecom Malaysia. Dr. Swaminathan got a wonderful opportunity to work as a project manager for the nationwide project Leading India, AI HTTPS Leading India AI lead by Dr. Deepak Gar, funded by Royal Academy of Engineering UK under Newton Bhabha funding scheme. Dr. Swaminathan is inclined to work mainly on computer vision, deep learning, and natural language processing research problems that cross the boundaries of multiple fields of cutting-edge multimedia research. His research interest includes video summarization, personalized multimedia retrieval, visual saliency detection, object detection, and tracking and sentiment mining. He has wide programming and experimental experience in processing visual, oral, and textual modelization of digital media. He is currently working on deep learning model optimization using sparsification. So now I'd like to invite Dr. Sridhar Swaminathan to share his valuable knowledge and immense knowledge and over this particular topic. Please, sir.
So thanks to Professor Sunil Nayak and Dr. Partha Roy.
Thanks a lot.
And yes, sir. So I'm very, very happy to be here. So thanks to the management of BIT Doog and Dr. Padmavati also. So again, I'm thankful to all of you who joined, because this is like a Sunday afternoon. This is actually a very, very precious time for everybody. This is like the personal time for everybody. You know, nobody can disturb in the Sunday afternoon. This slot should not be disturbed, okay? But anyway, you all like become ready to sacrifice your precious personal time for learning something which may be useful for your research. Okay, so the overall topic will be like today, how do we actually improve the model performance of any model? Let's say maybe a machine learning model or a deep learning model or a data mining model, any model. How do we improve the performance of the model? So I want this session to be very, very interactive, because I guess most of you know maybe something already about this model performance and maybe the different evaluation measures and all. Maybe you'd be having more doubts related to this content. So I would like you to like invite you for more interaction. So any doubt you have in the middle, you please don't hesitate to unmute yourself and then ask it, or you can put it in the chat box. So please don't like live with the doubts. So doubts has to be cleared right away. Whenever you have doubt, you have to like clear it. So the topic will be model evaluation improvement, and we'll be covering cross-validation, K-fold cross-validation, different evaluation metrics and scoring. So we'll cover like a mixture of different topics. So the thing is, when we actually take a deep learning or machine learning model, we actually go with the default parameters. So we try to train the model just by calling the model from a package called scikit-learn, sklearn. In Python, there is a package called sklearn. In that particular package, you have different methodologies for loading the data, pre-processing the data, and training the model and evaluating the model. So all this can be done using simple lines of code. Just a single line of code will actually do the training of the model. So if you want to maybe train a model, something like a logistic regression, you can just do something like LR equal to logistic regression, you just need to define the function lr dot fit of x train and then y train. That will fit the model. And here you don't actually give anything. You just like train it with the default parameter. But the thing is like, this model might not be always giving a good accuracy for both training and testing. So you need to actually improve the model. Through default parameter, sometimes it's very hard to actually find whether it is like a good model or not. So you need to like tune the model to find whether the model is doing well. So today we'll see all the different methodologies and measures for improving the model performance. By default, every model will just train just fine. For training, it'll give like maybe 90% accuracy. For testing, it'll give like maybe 89 or 88% of accuracy. But this is not the always like ensured. Sometimes the training itself will be like just a 60% accurate. Sometimes the training is good and then the testing will be like just a 69% accurate. So you will have like a different performance difference in your model performance. So we are going to see all of them and we are going to see like how we can clear them. So how do you improve a model? First thing what you can do is like maybe you need more data. So this is like a fundamental thing. We always say this, more data is actually better. More data. Why more data is better? Imagine that you have a photograph of maybe a very dangerous criminal or a terrorist. Okay. And you have just one picture, only one picture. Maybe a picture like a passport size picture, which he enclosed in the legal passport. Okay. There is no other picture. And if the same guy comes in a maybe a slightly different getup with like a mustache and then like cooling glass, it's very hard to like recognizing. He has come in a different getup. So the problem is actually because you have only one sample for this particular class. And if there are more data, then it's very easy to recognize. So one more example. So in social media and other platform, we used to upload the images all the time. So I also like do upload a lot of images in Facebook and my Twitter, in my site also. I used to have a lot of pictures of me. Okay. Maybe for some reason I become a terrorist. Some reason, maybe I'm just fed up with the corona. Then like corona is slower. I'm going to kill everybody faster. I become a psychopath and then become a terrorist. Okay. Then you have like maybe 10,000 pictures of me. And if I come in any getup, you know, with like a lot of beard and then mustache and then like a lot of hair, I'm like having like cooling glass and then put some like mole also in my face. Still, you can recognize, hey, Sridhar, what the hell you are doing? Because, you know, you have like thousands of pictures of me. So it's very easy to recognize me because you have seen all the varieties in my training itself, in your training set itself. Okay. So that's why we need more data. Okay. So that is like a very, very essential thing. If you have more data, then model performance will surely increase most of the time. Okay. That is the first point. Second point, data needs to have more diversity, not just more data. The data should be like diverse. Diverse means like a different type of data. So for example, if all my photos are like only just me smiling at the camera, nothing else. There is no change in the facial hair. There is no like maybe different hairstyle. There is no like cooling glass. Nothing is there. If the data lacks variety, then in that case, if I come in a different getup, then it's very hard to recognize me because my training data was maybe 10,000 images, but they were all looking like the same. There is no diversity. So you should have more data as well as you should have diversity within your data. Okay. So these two are very, very essential. And maybe sometimes the algorithm needs longer training. So if you take a case of maybe deep learning algorithms used to like train in terms of epochs. Going through the one data set, full data set is actually called epoch. One epoch means you have gone through the entire data set once, one by one. And maybe like after the first epoch, your accuracy may be just 80%. And you cannot claim that my model is actually doing bad. You need to make sure that you actually run the model in the same data set again and again. It needs more training actually. Okay. So maybe if you are dealing with the deep learning algorithm, you may need like maybe more number of hidden nodes and then more number of hidden layers. So these are very essential if you are working with the maybe deep learning algorithm. Okay. If you are working with like maybe machine learning algorithm, for example, decision tree, and you have kept a parameter, something like a maximum depth equal to maybe 5, and your model cannot go beyond that. You are saying that my depth of the tree should be like maximum 5 depth only. So in that case, what will happen? Maybe the model needs actually more depth. So in that case, your model representation, the size of your tree should be bigger. So that is actually called capacity in a machine learning model. Okay, what is the capacity? How much information the model can actually hold? That is the capacity. So in the deep learning, the capacity is actually more number of layers and more number of nodes. In the machine learning, in the decision tree, the capacity is actually the depth of your tree or maximum number of leaves in your tree, minimum samples per leaf in your tree. All these are your capacity of your model. Okay. So those are very, very important. And sometime if your model is like overfitting, you have a method called a regularization that also you can do. Okay. So if time allows, we'll see. And if your model is a deep learning model, maybe sometime you need to work with a different activation functions. Or if your model is a machine learning model, something like maybe support vector classification, and there is a parameter called a kernel. You need to like work with a different kernel. You can put a linear kernel, you can put a Gaussian kernel, you can put a radial basis function kernel, RBF kernel. Okay. So you need to change the model parameters to get the better performance. That is also one thing. Okay. And maybe other things which you can actually think of related to a model. So if you want to improve the model, there are many ways you can improve the model. It is not only the one way. And if the model performs like maybe very bad, it is not the blame of the model. It is the blame for us. Model is innocent. Model doesn't know like how to behave in a certain situation. We need to like make sure that model actually works better. Okay. All right. So usually when you have a large data, you don't like use the entire data into just a training. Okay. And what you can do is like you can divide the data into like two or three sets. Mostly we'll be like doing into two sets. One is a training set, other one is a testing set. Okay. So the thing is like the training set will be used for training the model. This is like reading a book. Okay. And that book contains like a lot of elements, like a quiz, and then there is like a lot of things are there. Okay. There is a theory, there is like some material, okay, images and videos. All these are your training stuff, which will help you for doing a better training. Testing set is like what you don't actually do in the training. Testing set is actually an exam, some kind of exam, where the questions you have never seen in the training, but maybe they are like little bit related to the training. Okay. So in the exam, you will not get the same questions that you actually received in the training, but you will actually receive a different questions. Okay. So the testing set is an exclusive set that you use only for testing the model. So you don't tune the model based on this. You try to maybe test your model better. Okay. Sometime the dilemma happens that maybe you have done maybe 100 hours of training your model. And at the end, you come to know that your model is just performing 50% accurate in the testing set. After the 100 hours of training, the testing set accuracy is just 50. Okay, so that 100 hours of training is actually 4 days, maybe 4 days and then maybe like 4 hours. Sorry, that is like exactly 3 days and then 22 hours. Okay. After 4 days, you come to know that your model is performing very purely in the testing set. You are very sad. You are thinking now like, man, I should have found that problem in the beginning itself. I don't need to actually train the model for 100 hours. Maybe in the 10th hour itself, I should have known that my model is actually not performing well for the unknown sample. Okay. So to clear that, what you do is like you maybe sometime use one more exclusive set, which you call it development set, or maybe cross validation set or validation set. Okay. And you just hold out. You just hold out. You don't use it for training. And maybe after every epoch, maybe one epoch is taking like 1 hour, and your model is actually doing 100 epoch. 100 times you are going through the same data set. So after the 1 hour of training, what you do is just like maybe take maybe 500 examples and then just do a validation. Training accuracy, 40%. Validation accuracy, 30%. Okay, after the second epoch, training accuracy, 45. Validation accuracy, maybe 28. It is like coming down. Again, third epoch, training accuracy, 47. Validation accuracy, 27. Now you have to like wake up because your validation set accuracy for the unknown sample is actually coming down. So this is for validating the training, whether the training is actually happening properly or not. Validation of the training. That's why we actually call it validation set or cross validation set. Okay. And the thing is like we use it for developing the model. You know, that is a small set of sample which you use it for developing the model. So sometimes it is called a dev set, sometimes it is called a validation set. Okay. So most of the time, 90% of the time, people just use only training and testing. Okay. And sometimes people may use validation also if your training process is really big enough. Okay. So if your model is maybe performing well for the validation also, for example, after every epoch, like training accuracy is improving, like maybe 5% or 3%, the validation accuracy is also maybe improving, like 53, 52. 65, 62, something like that. Then you are validating and your model is performing well. So the model is performing well for the unknown samples also. So most probably it will perform well on the testing set too. Okay. So that is the whole thing that you are going to use maybe sometime 3 sets or maybe sometime 2 sets for training your model. Okay. There is one more thing actually called cross validation with the K-fold. Okay, so let me give an example. What is a K-fold cross validation and where we can actually use that K-fold cross validation? Imagine that you have actually just shuffled the data and then got the training. Okay, so here maybe the training is actually like a mixture of all easy and tough samples, and maybe for some reason your testing set is just looking like the training set. Maybe most of the samples in your testing set is actually looking like maybe most of your training sample. So this particular set is actually containing only easy samples, which are looking like most of your training set. And maybe here in the training set, 30% of the samples are very, very tough samples, which are like very, very new, very unique images or very, very unique content, which are not similar to your rest of the samples. Okay. Now the thing is like you are actually having that particular 30% of tough samples only in the training. Okay. But your testing set is actually very, very easy. It's like a cake, piece of cake. The model is actually trained for the training set, 70% of the training, maybe 30% of the testing. Maybe for 70% of your training set, the model is performing maybe 90% accuracy, and maybe the testing set is looking just like the training set, and the accuracy of your testing set is actually maybe 95, and you are very, very happy. But the problem is this testing set is not going to guarantee that your model will always perform very well for the unknown samples. Luckily you got some easy samples, that's why your testing set accuracy is actually good here, but it is not guaranteed all the time. Imagine that during the random shuffling, this 30% of tough samples, if they had come in the maybe the 30% of your testing set, then the model performance would be like very, very poor. Okay. So just to check whether your model is performing in every part of your data set, what we will be doing, we'll be like training the same model in all parts of your data. Okay. We are not going to have just a fixed size of validation set or testing set, we are going to dynamically change it. How do we change it? Okay. So the K-fold cross validation will actually help us. So what we do, we need to segment the data set into equal parts. How many parts? You can choose K equal to maybe 5 parts. Then what we'll do, we'll like divide the data into 5 equal segments. So imagine that your data set contains 1000 samples. So each sample will have like 200, 200, 200 segments. Okay. What you will do? Take a model, something like Decision Tree. Okay. So first, what we are going to do, we are going to like train the first tree based on the like segments 1, 2, 3, 4. And we are going to do the testing based on the fifth. We are going to use all these segments for training, and you are going to use it one for testing, this segment for testing. Now what we can do, we can actually compute the accuracy of the model, and that accuracy may be like 95. Okay. Then what we can do, we can actually train one more decision tree that will be using like 1, 2, 3, 5 as training and the fourth for testing. So now this is a separate decision tree, which is going to use maybe all the parts except the fourth, and the fourth will be used for testing. And then maybe the testing accuracy is just 80%. Now what you have come to know, for this particular set of samples which are here, the model is actually not performing well. But imagine that you have taken only the fixed size of your training and testing set, then your testing set accuracy is very great there. Okay. So what you do is actually like maybe train the model in every other part. 4, 5, and then use 3 for training, sorry, testing, and then 1, 3, 4, 5, and then use 2 for testing, and then 2, 3, 4, 5, and then use 1 for testing. So here 93, here 60, and here 70. Okay. So you can see that there is a wide range among your accuracy of your testing set. What you can do, you can just take an average out of your all your cross validation, k-fold cross validation sets. Then that particular average will become your accuracy of the decision tree. Okay. So that is actually called k-fold cross validation. And you are cross validating that your model performs well for maybe all the particular samples, all set of samples. So now you have come to know that this particular segment 2 is containing some tough samples, and your model should be working well for this segment 2. Okay. So in practical, people can choose like a k equal to 5 or k equal to 6. Mostly people choose k equal to 5 or k equal to 10. And then make sure that your model is performing well in all the samples, all the subsets. And your cross validation accuracy is the average of your all folds. Okay. But again, this thing was like very, very famous in the machine learning, but not in the deep learning. In the deep learning, for neural network based training and testing, since your data set is actually large enough, you are going to use only training and testing set splitting. You're not going to use other kind of splitting, other kind of validation. You are going to just have holdout validation, which you just hold it. All right, if you have any doubts in between, you please let me know. So this is called cross validation, and many a time this will be very, very helpful for doing a better model evaluation. Okay.
Sir, just one doubt.
Yes, madam.
Sir, you said that we can take average of all the iterations.
Yes,
like
madam.
For all the folds.
Yeah.
So is there any method other than average, like mean or median sort of?
Yeah,
means average is particularly taking average,
because that is like a model performance in the entire data set, madam.
Sir.
So this particular accuracy that you are actually taking is actually going to tell you that whether your model is performing good in your all part of your samples.
Okay.
Yeah. So
maybe one fold gives very high accuracy and can drift all the iterations.
Sorry, madam, one fold gives high accuracy.
Very high accuracy, and in that case, it can drift the average towards the one side.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is like, this is not for improving the model performance. So maybe if you're actually doing research and then you want to show that your model performs superior and your model is having a good accuracy, in that case, this is not the way to showcase that your model performing well. But I'm getting it, madam. So when we say like model improvement, this is maybe for a model that you are developing for a company, and there is nobody to judge, and you don't need to prove anybody that you are going to achieve a 95% accuracy. So eventually, if your model is not performing well in the like whole experiment and the crash validation, the users of the particular application, they are not going to like the model also. So in that case, this is maybe an office setup scenario. So like, yeah, that is actually a, what do you call, trade off thing, that if you want to really do an evaluation, then you'll be getting a very poor performance, then that will not help us to publish some papers also. Many a time we need to actually like showcase that our model performs superior. Yeah.
I mean, there can be other methods too, which we can utilize.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah, yeah. So I'll tell you one more secret also. Sometimes people used to release data sets. The paper, like people who are publishing the paper, they'll be releasing the data set also. So they will be maybe sometime proposing a method also, and then they'll be releasing the data set also. What they will do, they'll actually take all the samples which are like going to perform well for their own methodology. So they'll propose a method, and then they'll find all the samples which are giving good accuracy for the their proposed method, and then they'll keep it in the testing set of the data set. And then they'll release it publicly saying that this is my training and this is my testing. And if you run this particular data set for their method, it will surely give a good accuracy for testing, because sometimes they handpick the samples which are performing good for the particular method they are proposing. And maybe that is a bad thing for other people who are trying to actually propose a good method. So that is also one trick that people used to actually do. But
nice trick.
Yeah, madam, it is a trick, and that is a like cheap trick that they use for publishing papers. I mean, literally to publish a paper, it's not very like very, very difficult. Once you know the trend, it's very, very easy. So
okay.
Using number, we can play a lot. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yes, madam. Yeah. Great. So this is K-fold crash validation. And so this will be like very, very useful if you're actually doing maybe a data related competitions. There is a lot of competitions in the internet. So there is a Kaggle competitions. So in the Kaggle.com, you'll be having a lot of competitions. So if you go to competitions, so these are all like new competitions, which are for like COVID-19 detection for $100,000. So in these scenarios, people will not be releasing the actual label for the testing set, and we need to just predict it and then upload to the server. In that case, we'll be like actually selecting the model based on the K-fold crash validation and every other thing. We will not be just using the same sample for training and same sample for testing. So sometimes the model actually goes more biased towards the testing set. Sometimes the model will indirectly try to memorize your testing set. So to avoid those, we try to break that kind of monopoly, because you are actually having the same set of samples for the testing set. We try to break that monopoly. It is like for every other NTEM exam, you are having the same question paper for every year. And indirectly, people will be like automatically preparing for the same question paper. So that we don't want to happen. So we try to change the question often, just to confuse the model. Okay. So this is like some competition, and there is Quora Lab also, which is very, very famous. And Quora Lab also throws a lot of competitions. If you are actually interested in doing competition for conferences and workshops, you can actually do this. You can see that ICCV 2021, this is actually for International Conference of Computer Vision, like A-Star conference in the computer vision and artificial intelligence. So they are throwing some competition here. And if you actually perform really good in this competition, and you can publish a paper in the ICCV for free as a like group paper. So Mocha ICMI 2020, this is actually part of this conference, ICMI conference. Okay. And there is one more site also for your reference. It's called ML Contest. If you go here, you will find like all the different platforms and the contests which are going. So some of them have like a June deadline, May deadline. Some of them have like October, predicting earthquake. And then some prize money is also there. Kaggle, AI Crowd, and then Driven Data. Driven Data is also one more platform for doing competition. So sometime you do competition, and then you actually get some good experience with the real data set, and sometime the publication also. So this is a driven data. There is many other sites. AI Crowd, that is also one more good site for challenges. Music demixing challenge, Izmir. This is a conference, I think. Music demixing means you are trying to remove the background music from the audio, a cappella and the background music. It's called source separation and it is conducted by the Sony. So you should know what will be the importance of this kind of technology. Okay. Other than the money, you have a lot of benefits in doing the competition. So when doing the competition, this will be very, very helpful. Okay. So how do you decide, how do you split the data set? Sometime you decide I'll have 70% for training, 30% for testing. Sometime people choose 90% for training, 10% for testing. Okay. Sometime people choose maybe 50% for training, 50% for testing. Now, obviously you'll be having a question can I do 30% of the data set for training and 70% of the data set for testing? The answer is, of course you can do, but do we want to do it? The answer is no. You don't want to do something giving less number of sample for training and more number of sample for testing. 50-50 is okay. That is considered too much good. 50% training, 50% testing, but 70% of testing comparing to just 30% of training, that is very, very difficult. This is not a fair evaluation. You should not be doing something like this. That is something asking some question out of syllabus. We have taught only just 2 units of the entire syllabus, asking questions from the rest of the 3 units. Just to trick the people, And then if the same thing had happened to us, then we'll be angry. What the hell, man? You have not taught the unit 5, but most of your questions are actually from unit 5. I have never seen a goddamn thing. So we should be fair with the model. You should show at least half of your data set for training. Rest of the half you can do for testing. Okay, this is a fair case. If you are deciding that you'll have a validation set, also you can do something 60-20-20 or maybe 80-10-10 or 90-5-5. It's not always necessary that you keep a validation set equal to your testing set. You can do something like this: 80 for training, 15 for testing, 5 for validation. Validation is going to just validate your training set, training process. So it doesn't need to be large. You just need to have some number of samples there. And we assume that this 5% of samples are not related to maybe 80% of your training samples. They are very, very different samples. Okay. In the era of deep learning, the number of samples are actually in sometime lakhs and sometime in millions. So in that case, even you can do 99% with the training and just 0.5% for testing, 0.5 for validation. You know why? Because 99% will be a really huge number. Even 0.5% will be a huge number. If the data set is something maybe 10 lakh or 1 million, 0.5% is actually 5,000 images or 5,000 samples. So 5,000 is a big number. So it's not about just the percentage, it is about the number of samples also. Okay. So it's up to us, how do we want to decide it? And sometimes when you download the data set from external sources, they'll be releasing the data set as a zip file or a RAR file or a 7-zip file. And usually they will not give it as a single file, they'll give it as 2 or 3 files. Something testing set dot RAR. And then the training set will be sometime labeled as train val set, train-val dot RAR. Train val set. So that train val set is actually meaning for training plus validation set. If you want to do the whole training with the train val set, you can do it. Or if you want to have some validation also, you can take out some samples from the train val set and then keep it as a validation set. But testing set will never change. The report in your publication is going to be the testing set accuracy. Okay. All right. So there is a very, very important development set and testing set. We need to choose the particular set very wisely, because if there is a bias in the particular testing set or development set, we'll be actually going in a wrong direction. Okay. So sometime even a bad distribution will be like causing us too much of accuracy. What do you mean by bad distribution? Imagine that you are actually like maybe training the model based on some data, like training the data based on some data from Mumbai, maybe the house price data, and you are going to test the model based on Chandigarh. Not actually going to perform well for the new data because your distribution of your Mumbai data is different. The distribution of your Chandigarh data will be different. Okay, so this is called a data distribution mismatch. If you are going to like maybe do a validation or testing with the Chandigarh data, then your training should also be based on the Chandigarh data, should be matching the distribution. I'll give you one more clear example. In the surveillance scenario, there is a application, gender and age detection. From the surveillance camera, you want to like detect the gender and the age of a person. Okay, detecting the human is one thing, and then you want to classify the gender and you want to classify their age. Okay, imagine that there is a supermarket, and in the supermarket you just want to know from your surveillance camera how many boys are there, how many girls are there, how many old people are there, how many children are there, male children, female children. So you just want to do some analysis in which section the like children are like more, in which section the elder people are more. They want to do some analysis. So they will develop a, like maybe a data set based on the Western countries. So in that Western country, like people will be like there, and then they can actually do a classification. Imagine that you are going to use the data set from the Western country, same data set. Okay. And you are going to deploy the model in India, maybe. The Western country, you know, the ladies used to wear frock. There is a like a dress called frock. These frocks will be like worn by only the ladies in the Western world. But if you maybe go to South India, where I am from, men used to wear something called dhoti, you know, vesti or dhoti. And it will be looking just like the frock. Model will be thinking like, oh, it is actually a female. What the hell? Because your Western countries, the long frocks are like full tops or bottom were actually worn by the ladies only. But in the India, like ladies used to wear sari and then the men used to wear dhoti, and that may be looking like a frock. But in the Western people, that frock will never be worn by a man. Okay. So that will be actually a data distribution mismatch, because your Western country data will have a different distribution and your Indian data distribution will be very, very different. Okay. Maybe if you are actually training the model based on the Indian data set, the trousers, small trousers, most of the time will be worn by the small boys and maybe sometime men. Okay. But in the Western world, there is no discrimination. Very small trousers will be worn by the ladies. Okay. That is very natural there. And maybe if you are training based on the Indian data and deploying in the Western country, the model will do a mistake there. They'll classify the all like ladies as a men because they are wearing the trousers. Okay. Or small 3/4. So this is the data distribution mismatch. We have to be very, very careful. It may cause a lot of us with like a very bad accuracy in the deployment. Okay. All right. So I think most of you might already know about evaluation metrics like accuracy, very popular one, accuracy. Okay. Other than that, there are like measures, something called precision and recall. Okay. Especially if your model is a kind of like a retrieval model. You're asking the model to retrieve all the like maybe cancerous patients from a database, and the model is doing a classification and retrieving the results. Okay. So how do we evaluate it? Mostly we'll be going with accuracy. Maybe there are like 200 samples totally, and 100 samples are actually cancerous, 100 samples are like not cancerous people. Out of the like whatever the model has actually done the classification, you find like maybe the 150 samples were actually correct and 200 samples were overall, and you get a 70% of accuracy. Out of that, maybe your model mistake like 70 samples from here, 75 samples from here. So you have accuracy, but that is not going to give a detail of how much the model made a mistake for cancerous people. Okay. So there are some evaluation measures for doing that. Any doubts you have, please let me know. I think I heard diverse data is required for all kind of ML, just for image process. Professor, I think the diverse data is actually required for all kind of problems, because let's say that this is just a one visual example, but let me just say, for example, there are maybe two classes. So one is a class which is actually like, just take a points based samples. One class may be like this. And other class is actually maybe something like this. Okay. And if you just train based on the whole data set, what will happen is like your model will be training for this kind of margin. Okay. But imagine that maybe your training is actually based on this particular samples. Only based on these particular samples, and you left out these samples and these samples of those two classes. Then what will happen? The model that you are going to train now is going to have a distribution like this, because this line is going to separate this part out and this part out. Okay. And the distribution is actually mismatch here. The data doesn't have this kind of distribution. The data has this distribution. Okay. Imagine that maybe from this distribution, you uniformly take the samples. Maybe instead of all the sample, you have taken like only few sample, but from everywhere. And from maybe from this particular class also, not all the sample, from this. Okay. Now given a training set of this, your model will clearly like train a line like this. So it is actually from where we draw the samples, from where we like take that subset. So this particular data set distribution mismatch will be available in every problem. So in case of maybe, I'll give you some more example. In case of like maybe audio data, most of us had a tough time with like all the voice engines, like Siri, Alexa, all these voice engines till 2015 or 17, because till that time, the Alexa and the Google Voice and all these applications used to recognize only the speech of Western people who are speaking proper English in their own accent, not like proper English, but in their own accent. And we used to like mimic like English people. Hello, Sri, how are you? You need to mimic like them. In that case, it was giving output. But if you are saying something in an Indian accent, hey, Alexa, what do you think about the today's weather? That is an Indian accent. That time, it was not able to do that. And the distribution of the training set was only the Western people. And now Alexa is actually improved, because they have trained the Alexa, Siri and all for the all Indian languages and all Indian accents, all the English accents around the world. You can speak English in Jamaican accent or Australian accent, still it can recognize. So the problem is there in the audio also, data distribution mismatch. It happens often with the geography. It happens like often with the different lifestyle or culture. In the same geography, you have different class of people, different gender of people. So if your training is only based on the maybe male, the model will fail to perform well for the female. Maybe for some reason, your voice recognition software is trained mostly on male data. Male people have given their voices, but for female voices, the model will not perform well. So similarly for male, within the male also, all the age groups should be there. If your model is trained only based on people who are from 15 to 25, then it may not recognize the old people's voice who are in the 65. So this variety we need to bring in every kind of data, whether it is audio or text, or maybe whether it is a like point data or any other data. Maybe if it is a the COVID also is the same problem. Like the Indians will respond differently to different medicines, and the foreigners will be like responding differently to different medicines. You cannot give the same medicine to everybody. So because people eat a different food and they have a different genetics and they live in a different place, an Indian who is living in the US for the last 2 decades, they will have a different body, like metabolism. You cannot like treat them as an Indian who are in India or in Uttar Pradesh. Okay. So this problem happens, and we try to bring more variety in the data set. Only then the application will be global. Otherwise, you cannot sell an application saying that my model is 95% accurate for Indian data. I cannot say like that. Only Indians are allowed to use that app. You cannot say like that. Okay. Same thing happens in the text also, the way we write, the way we express ourselves. Okay. So data distribution mismatch is a really big problem. Okay. Oh, where we were? We were actually looking at the different evaluation metrics. We were actually discussing about the accuracy part. So there are two more like evaluation measures which are actually called as precision and recall. Let me give you an example. What is precision and recall? So imagine that data set is actually having 200 samples. 100 of them have like a cancer, 100 of them no cancer. So it is a data set well distributed 50-50 data set. Okay. So maybe we are training the model on some other data and we are applying the model on this particular data. Okay. So the model is applied and then the model is actually bringing, it is saying like 100 people have cancer, or maybe just say that maybe out of this 80 people have cancer, 120 people no cancer. This is the model output. Do you think that the model retrieved like all of them cancerous people correctly and then all of the like non-cancerous people correctly? So sometime there will be mistake, right? So out of the 80 people that the model brought as cancer, maybe only 40 people have cancer and the rest of the 40 people here, they don't have cancer. Similarly, in the non-cancerous category, like here, only like 60 people have cancer, 60 people no cancer. So you need to add these two. You need to add these two. Okay. So the model retrieved 80 people as cancerous and then 120 people as not cancerous. And out of the 80, only 40 people have cancer. 40 people don't have cancer. Okay. So if you like take this particular model, then the accuracy will be something like out of which you made like 40 correct here and then 60 correct here. So 40 plus 60 divided by 200, that will be 50% accurate. Okay. So now precision is actually the ratio between what you retrieved and how many of them actually are correct out of what you retrieved. You retrieved 80, out of them 40 are correct. So now precision is actually 40 divided by 80, which is actually 0.5. You are precise 50% of the time. You retrieved 80, but out of them only half of them are correct. Okay. Maybe imagine that out of 80, maybe all 80 are like cancerous. So that 80 divided by 80, the precision will actually become 100. You are precise 100% of the time. Now recall is actually out of all the cancerous people, how many of them you retrieved correctly? That is the recall. So you retrieved 80, but out of them 40 are correct. So that is 40. But total people who have cancer are 100. How many of them you are able to cover? Only 40. So that is the division that your model is actually trying to bring only 40 cancerous people out of the 100 cancerous people. That is actually 0.4 or 40% recall. Recall is actually called as coverage. How much you are able to cover from the whole data. Precision is like out of what you retrieved, how much you are accurate. Okay. So in this scenario, which one do you think like very important? Precision or recall? What do you need to have more? Either or, please choose only one. Precision or recall? Anybody?
But I think precision will be more important.
Okay, madam. So out of what you retrieve, that should be correctly classified, right?
Yeah, okay. I think so. That's just my perspective.
Okay, so I'll give you a scenario. So maybe like when you, so how do you decide like how much samples to actually bring here? Whenever you run a model on a data set for 100 sample, then model will actually give a kind of probability score to each and every sample. For some sample will be like 0.90 for cancer, 0.92, 0.56, 0.01. So this is like no cancer, because for cancer it is giving a very low accuracy, like a confidence score. So maybe if you put a threshold of like 0.5, you are actually getting some kind of samples. Maybe 80 samples are actually more than 0.5 threshold. Okay. So sometime what you will be doing, I just want to like retrieve only the highly confident samples. My model should be highly confident on some of the samples. So maybe you put a cutoff like more than 0.90, I want to bring all the samples. So like when you give a cutoff of like more than 0.90, all the more than 9.90 will be retrieved. So maybe like out of 100, you are retrieving only 10 samples as cancer. Okay. And out of them, you are maybe right. You brought all the 10 people correctly because they have a high confidence score from the model. If you run model logistic regression or maybe SVM or a decision tree, or some other like a neural network, you'll be getting a probability score for or confidence score for every sample. Okay. So if you're lucky, maybe out of 10 samples, all 10 are like maybe having cancerous, and then your precision is actually 100%, right? You are 100% precise. But the problem is you actually left out 90 people out of here. Those 90 people, we are going to label that they don't have cancer, no cancer, and they are going to like be let us free. And those people will not be going through the treatment because they are classified as not cancerous. Now, which one is important? Still precision, madam?
No, sir.
Do you think recall is now important, madam?
Sir, actually, you said you just need to choose one.
Yeah.
Otherwise, my answer would have been that both are equally important. In different scenarios.
Yeah, but in this case, like which are important? So there is like one more trick also. I'm not like judging you, madam, like whether you are right or wrong. Just a discussion, okay? So there is one more trick what you can do to get 100% recall. This is like 100% precision. Maybe you just bring only one sample, like 0.99. You will get like one sample. One guy will be like having cancer. 1/1 is equal to 100. But we left out actually 99 people. So in that case, our recall will be 1/100, which is like 0.01, 1%. You are able to cover only 1% of your whole thing. So there is a way we can achieve a 100% recall also. What we can do, we can just tell that all 200 people have cancer. Okay. No need for any model. I just say like all 200 people have cancer. So this is my model retrieval. Out of them, 100 is already having cancer. 100 is not having cancer. So precision will be what? Precision will be 100/200. That will be 50%. Recall will be 100/100. Because you brought all the 100 out of the 100. So now you will be having 100% recall. Like I brought everybody because we literally brought everybody. We said that everybody have cancer. Now like having 100% recall is actually a very, very dangerous thing. You know why? Because we are going to say that 200 people have cancer and 100 people will be going through the chemotherapy. Rest of the 100 people who also don't have the cancer will be going through the same therapy. And anybody who is not having the cancer going through the chemo will get the cancer. That is the problem. So it is like sometimes safe to say that you need to detect them properly rather than saying that somebody is actually a non-cancerous and we are saying that this guy has a cancer and he is going through the therapy. That is very, very dangerous. So here precision is more important. You need to be precise, but we need to worry about the recall also, no? Like because bringing only 10 people out of the 100, 10/100 is actually just a 10% of recall. We don't want like a 10% recall. We want to like bring more people. So how do we choose a threshold? Any idea, madam, or anybody? How do we choose a threshold? Like how much data to bring? Because that is going to eventually like affect your recall also. If you bring less samples, recall will be very less. If you bring more sample, precision will become less. So which one do you think like will work? What do you think?
Please repeat the last line, means how the data affect precision and recall.
Yeah, madam, because if you are like bringing only the highly confident samples, which are having a high confidence score like 0.99 from the model. So if you bring only less number of samples as a cancerous people, then obviously precision will be high because you are going to be accurate in whatever you are going to say. And recall will be low because you are bringing only less number of samples. If you are maybe like just slightly lowering your threshold going till like 0.5, maybe you are bringing more samples. But when more samples are there, there is a obvious like chance of doing more mistakes. So in that case, most of the time, your recall will be improving, but your precision will be coming down. Maybe out of that all sample, you brought maybe 120 samples as cancerous people. Maybe you did like 20 mistake. Okay, so that case like 100 by 2, 120 will be your precision. Recall will be like 100 by 100. So both are actually trade-off. You cannot improve both of them at the same time. Either you need to be very accurate or you need to be covering all the samples. So my question is, how do we decide the threshold? How much samples to bring? Any idea? Anyone? How do we bring? So sometime you are working with the new data, you have no idea whether like 50% will be having cancer, 50% will not be having cancer. So in that case, how do we decide the threshold? It's very, very hard, you know? So the thing is, in your training, maybe the model, when the model was training, you found that the number of cancerous people was actually 50% of the data most of the time, and non-cancerous people also 50% most of the time. And the data that comes to the hospital also has like a similar case. Half of the people have cancer, half of the people don't have the cancer. So in that case, what you can do? You can just like maybe do sorting of your like samples. Sort them in a like decreasing order 0.99, 0.98, 0.96. And then choose half of the samples. And then that will become your threshold. Whatever the last sample is having, that is the threshold. In that case, we don't worry about the threshold. We just bring the top 50% of samples. Because you are already aware that 50% of your data will contain cancerous people. So sometime maybe for a hospital, whatever the number of patients you are getting, 100, only 10% of the people only have cancer most of the time after the testing. So what you can do, you can choose your threshold based on the top 10% of people who are coming to the hospital. Okay. So sometime that threshold can also be tuned during the model training. The model training can help you to choose a particular threshold. In the training, maybe you put a threshold of 80%, 0.80. Maybe in a new data also, that same 0.80 will help you. So that is called the empirical evaluation, or like choosing a particular parameter empirically, how much threshold to give. So some sample which are having like maybe the confidence score or a probability score near to zero, we can clearly say that they don't have cancer. Some sample which are having like greater than the 90%, we can clearly say that they have cancer. But the dilemma is actually the middle people who are having like maybe 30 to 70% confidence score. These are the dilemma. Okay. So based on the distribution of the non-cancerous and cancerous people, we can choose a threshold, and through that we can evaluate the model. Okay. So I'm going to give you one more example. You are going to tell the scenario. Okay. So maybe there is a like a case of some crime. Okay. It happened in a village. In fighting the crime, like the police went to the village and then brought a lot of criminals, and then they like produced them to the judge also. Okay. So in fighting the crime, there are two people who are there. Police department and the law department. Law and order, police, and then only the law and judgment will be the jury. Okay. So in fighting the crime, in detecting the criminal, who will focus on precision? Who will focus on recall? Any idea? In detecting or fighting the crime, in detecting the criminal, who is going to focus on the precision? Who is going to focus on improving the recall?
Focus on precision.
Okay, madam.
Police should focus on recall.
Okay. So jury will be focusing on precision and police will be working on recall. Yes, madam, you are right. You know, whenever there is a problem happening in the village or like some issue happens, police will go there and then bring the entire village to police station. And then he will like keep 100 people in a like a big maybe room. Then like torture them continuously for 2 days without food and water. And then they'll produce these 100 people to the jury. And say like, oh, judge, my lord, these 100 people are criminals. Okay, all of them are criminals. Because police wants to like cover all the criminals. So it is, they are like bringing all the innocents also. But the jury, like the judge will be actually going through the 100 people. And then like, why the hell everybody is bleeding? What the hell happened? Then police will be like, yeah, we were investigating. This is the way you investigate, goddammit. All the people are like starving to death with the broken jaws and knees. What the hell you have done? Well, we were just investigating. Then the jury will like just pick only like 10 people. Say that only these 10 people are criminal. You can just release the 90 people. They are non-criminals. Okay. So the police, they focused on the bringing all the criminals. So they brought all the samples. And then the jury, they thought like only 10 people are criminal. They are going to punish only these people. And maybe out of them, one of them may be like missing here. Maybe there were 11 criminals. One of them came here. Okay. That doesn't matter. It's okay to like punish a criminal, but it is not okay to punish a innocent. Okay. So that's why you cannot improve both of them at the same time. Police wants to fight the crime by arresting every other people they see. But judge want to like punish only people who are like most likely to be a criminal. Okay. That's why you cannot improve both of them at the same time. And that's why these people always have a ladai, fight with each other, because they are working on a totally a different thing. The trade-off is actually there. That's why people like police department and the judge department and the lawyers, they like hate each other most of the time because their objective is different. There is a conflict of interest. Okay. So again, it depends upon the situation. It depends upon the case to case, which one you have to focus more, but it depends upon the application. Okay. So let us discuss like all the applications also side by side. And we'll see, sometime people are working on precision, sometime people are working on recall. If you want to like balance both of them, and you can find a harmonic mean of the precision and recall, which is actually called as F measure or F1 score. That is 2 divided by 1 plus 1 by P plus 1 by R recall. Then F1 score is going to give you which model is going to balance the good balance between precision and recall. You can see that the model 2 has the highest precision, but it has a very low recall. So it is reflected in your F1 score. So here the model is like having a below precision and then a little bit higher recall than the model B. So it is balancing both of them. So you'll have a better F1 score. So you choose a model A, which is actually a good model. Okay. So sometime there are other measures other than the precision and recall. There are other measures. Something like running time of your model. That is also a major role. Imagine that you are working with a neural network. Neural network will be like maybe taking too much of time for running the model. So the running time is like 200 milliseconds or 2 seconds, and the accuracy is actually very high because it is neural network. And it is safe to use because the accuracy is actually greater. Okay. And sometime maybe you are working with a logistic regression, very simple model. It is taking only 20 milliseconds, but it is very, very slow. And it is like very, very, it is very, very faster, but it is very, very inaccurate sometimes. it has 10% of error. And maybe you have a decision tree, which is also faster, like a little bit slower than your logistic regression, but we have a good accuracy. Okay. So if the model capacity is more, then the accuracy will be high. Running time will be like very, very high. It will be a slower model. When the model capacity is smaller, accuracy will become small. Running time will be faster. And sometime if you are working with a lower accuracy, your model is actually not safe to use. Okay, out of all the three models, which model do you think is good? A, B, C. What do you think? Anyone?
Depends on the scenario.
Okay, so which application needs a good accuracy, madam? Which application needs good speed? Any idea?
Let's suppose we are making a program for Mars rover landing. So in that case, accuracy is more important. Running time is not that much important.
Yeah, but people can wait.
Yeah, people can wait. And if suppose there's a scenario like for something having a very quick decisive time. So in that case, maybe we can compromise with the accuracy. Maybe, still not sure.
Yeah. So if the yes, sir. Go ahead, please.
Like the case that we are working now with COVID vaccination.
Yeah.
Accuracy is not accuracy. Obviously, accuracy is required, but not up to that extent.
Important. Yeah.
Speed is more important.
So in that case, we want to cover more number of people within limited time because the spread is actually like timely. So we compromise on the accuracy part. Yeah, very good example. So the thing is like whenever if it is a maybe a related to security or like a, maybe a health related issue, most of the time we can just like ignore this vaccination thing. But when it comes to maybe therapy or like anything related to medicine or healthcare, or any sensitive application needs a high accuracy where we can compromise on the speed part. For example, given a MRI, it is going to classify whether the MRI scanning is having a cancer segment or not. People can wait. People can wait half an hour to run the model. People can wait like even one day to get the results. But it has to be accurate. So we can compromise on the speed part. But we cannot compromise on the accuracy part. Maybe after the model is giving a decision, if you are going to take one more action after the decision, and that action is a very sensitive action, like taking a medicine, then we want like this accuracy to be a more important one. And some application doesn't need any like good accuracy, but we just want a good speed. That's all. One example is like, Googling, whenever you type something in Google, we want Google to actually give at least some results which are relevant. So in the like maybe out of 10 results, maybe 5 are actually not related to your query, but you are okay with that. You can like forgive the Google for bringing some stupid results, but you cannot forgive the Google if you are in a hurry and you are giving a query and Google is taking like 10 minutes to process your query. And it is saying like, oh, Aram se bhai, let me process the whole query, get all the accurate information. Then like after 1 minute, I'm still processing. Can you wait? I'm done 98% and then in 98% it just like rotates for 5 minutes. In that case, you cannot like compromise on the speed part. You'll be saying like Google is stupid. Let me go with the Bing. Okay. So similarly, like you have this facial recognition or like a thumbprint recognition for attendance system. Whenever sometime you put your thumb and then you are like waiting for the beep, sometime you need to put like 2 or 3 times to get recognized. It is totally okay. But for every thumb, if it is taking like 1 minute, then people will be waiting in a line. Because for everybody, it will take 1 minute. Maybe it is accurate, but we don't want accuracy there. So if time is more important, then we want actually this one. So can you give any example where both speed and like accuracy is important? Where you cannot compromise on either one. You have to focus on both.
So the same scenario you said just now, biometric.
Biometric, like we can compromise on the accuracy part, madam. But some application where you cannot compromise on the accuracy also.
If it's not recognizing correctly, then...
That is totally okay. You can write your name over there and then you can leave. So there is like obviously an alternative solution for every electronic system. If the like internet is not working, you have a paper and pen machine. Yes.
Sir, if the patient is on ventilator, that time all the devices need to be very accurate and timely. It has to...
it has to be accurate and timely. Yeah, any real-time system which are working with the very sensitive data. So somebody is like maybe in a ventilator, it has to be accurate as well as it has to be timely. Yeah, really good. So there is like one more application, self-driving car, where AI is the main component of it. So in self-driving, you need to like detect the path, and then you need to detect the other objects like other cars and then pedestrians and the signals, everything you need to recognize. Can you, madam, mute yourself because I can hear some wind sound and then air sound. Yeah, thank you so much. Great. So sometime the self-driving car, you need to actually detect all the objects and other people and everybody. So you need to detect it accurately and it has to be detecting faster. Because maybe to detect the accurate objects, maybe you put a model and then it is taking too much of time, then we cannot actually compromise on the running time of your car. The car cannot be like waiting for the people to get recognized and then move for 10 feet. Again it stops. It should not be like that. And maybe people are like in a hurry and then they don't want to like compromise on the like speed part. Can they compromise on the accuracy part? No, they cannot compromise on the accuracy part also. So model may be running faster, and then if it is failing to detect some of the object, then what will happen? Then this self-driving car will be committing a crime by the end of the day. Then nobody can save that car from getting arrested, okay? So in those kind of scenario, we need actually both speed and accuracy at the same time. But how people actually do it? People actually try to achieve the accuracy first, something like 98 with a big model, and then this big model, they'll try to like do some kind of tricks to improve the speed part. Improving the speed, you can actually do some kind of tricks. You can use like more GPUs. You can improve the speed of your CPU. There are ways to speed up your model, but there are like no ways to speed up your accuracy will never change, but speed can change. Depends upon your infrastructure, depends upon your like computation that you are actually going to do. So if your GPU speed is increased and then your CPU clock time is increased, then your model will be running faster. So in that way you can improve the model. Or maybe that you try to like change the model a little bit. Maybe instead of float 32 or float 64, you try to work with a lower precision multiplications, because those multiplications are like taking too much of memory, too much of your like computation also. So if you are like converting your float 64 to float 32, you'll be losing some precision. Out of that, maybe you'll be losing like a 0.05% of your accuracy, but that is totally okay, because maybe losing 0.05 accuracy, you are going to gain some maybe 2x speed. You can compromise on the this much loss from the model, okay? So this is the way like we can focus on the model performance, okay? So let me show you like all the different evaluation measures quickly, one by one. So let us see some classification measures which are very, very famous. So for example, this is the given data set and you need to like predict which one of them are like positive, which one of them are negative samples. So the prediction model will give something like this, will give something like a predicted negative, predicted positive. Out of them, you have like only 4 correct predictions, okay? And 2 wrong predictions in the predicted positive. In the predicted negative, you have like 6 correct predictions in the predict negative, but 2 of them are actually wrong. So there is a one more measure also, which is actually true positive, false positive, true negative, false negative. Okay. So if your actual value is 1 and then the predicted value is also 1, that is called true positive. This is the true positive, which are actually in the green color. What is like a false positive? Actual value is 0, but the predicted value is 1. These are the false positive. Actual value is 0, but it is predicted as 1. So here 2 are actually the false positive. True positive is actually 4. What is false negative? Actual is 1, but predicted as 0. It is a negative, but deducted falsely. Okay. This is the false positive. Actual is positive. Sorry, it is false negative. It is predicted as negative, but actual is positive. Then there is true negative, where actual is negative, predicted also negative. So rest of the like 6 people will be true negative. Okay. So these are all also like very important. So we call it actually confusion matrix. Out of them, how many of them are positive? How many we predicted positive? How many of them are negative? How many we predicted negative? So eventually we want to actually improvise the true positive rate and the true negative rate. We have to reduce the false positive and the false negative. False positive is like very, very important because it is a false prediction of the wrong label. It is actually a negative value, but you predicted it as a positive. And it is actually called sometimes false alarm. We are giving an alarm, but it is a false alarm. So this is like some kind of ignoring. You should have given like 1, you should have predicted as 1, but you are not giving alarm. This is like ignoring. So both of them we need to reduce. We don't want a false alarm. We don't want to ignore the things also. Whenever it happens, you need to say that it actually happened. Okay, so this is the confusion matrix, and using confusion matrix also, you can compute the accuracy. That is like a true positive plus true negative divided by total number of samples. And you can compute the precision also, true positive divided by the retrieved positive values, true positive plus false positives. This is the retrieved positive values. Then you have like recall, which is the like coverage, which is the true positive and how many of them are actually positive. Okay. How many of them are actually the positive class? So this true positive, true negative, false positive, false negative, all this confusion matrix, pressure and recall should be computed individually for each class. Okay. If it is a binary classification, we focus on the particular class. But if it is a multi-class classification, for each class, we need to focus on this. And finally, we need to take the average out of all the things. Okay. So that is the whole scenario. All right, so F1 score, I think we have already seen. So there is something called a prescient and recall curve, what we can actually do. So in your data set, you process like all the sample, and then every sample will have like some kind of confidence score, 0.56, 0.07, okay? So what you can do is like choose different threshold, like first my threshold will be 0.95, second my threshold will be 0.90. third 0.85, and then you choose the threshold till 0.05. So you'll be maybe choosing like 20 different thresholds. For each threshold, you find the precision and the recall, and then you plot it. When you choose a higher threshold, obviously precision will be near 1. Recall will be near 0 because you are bringing only very small number of samples. Okay. And when your threshold is actually getting increased, the precision will be like coming down and your recall will be like going up as the time goes. So what is happening? Your like recall is actually going up and then the precision is actually coming down. And if you plot this precision recall curve for different models, any model which is actually in the extreme upper left, upper right is actually a good model. This model is a good model, algorithm 2, because the precision is actually high, recall is also high. So it has to go something like this. Okay, so this is called precision recall curve. Very, very important aspect, especially in information retrieval and like binary classification. So there is a ROC curve and there is a, like area under curve score also. So if you actually try to plot the true positive rate and the false positive rate, then you will be getting a curve like this for different threshold. Again, using the same methodology, you can just plot it. Okay. So the initially the true positive rate will be like very less, and then the false positive rate also will be like very less. But as the time goes, when your threshold goes high, then your model will be going like this. So any good model is actually having a true positive rate high, but false positive rate should be low. It should be like going like this. Any model that goes into the upper left direction, in this direction, is a good model. If it comes down something like this, it's a bad model. Okay, so this is actually called a ROC curve. And under the area is actually called a ROC AUC score. Area under the curve. What is the area under this curve? For a good model, this area under the curve will be high because it is actually going in the extreme upper left direction. So the area under the curve will be obviously a high number. So you can choose a model which is actually having an area under curve, a higher number. So here you are seeing like a random forest method is having a high area under curve. And then the logistic regression is having a low area under curve. A perfect fit will be having an area under curve of 1. Okay. So image retrieval and then video retrieval, Google search, and then any content based retrieval will be having the precision and recall. Okay. So there is a one more measure called average precision also. So whenever you are having like a hit every time, whenever your model is bringing a like a hit every time, there you try to achieve your like precision score at that particular time, and then you try to average the whole precision whenever you hit something, whenever you correctly predict something. So at those position, you try to calculate the precision every time and then take an average of it. It's called average precision. For a good model, the average precision will be really high. For a bad model, which is correcting, like detecting the, like doing the proper correction only in the later part of your retrieval, will be having a lower score. So here, all your hits are actually here. So here, first hit is here, and then the second hit is actually in the fourth position. Okay. So this is the average precision. If you are like maybe doing a lot of queries, different queries, and then computing the average precision for different queries, and then take the average of it, that is called mean average precision. Again, one more different measure. This is very much useful for information retrieval, image classification, object detection. Those problems, you'll be seeing the mean average precision. Okay. So sometime,
sir, what can be the accurate measures for recommendation systems?
For recommender system, I think it is the precision. Because for a user, we are trying to like give a recommendation and we want to find whether he is actually liking the recommendation or not. So it should be the precision, whatever you are retrieving, that the user has to find it relevant.
Okay, sir.
And most of the time, the like recommender system is a funny problem because we try to do a regression in the recommender system for like a user 1, user 2, user 3, and then we have like item 1, item 2, item 3. So user like a given 5 for here, and then one more user given like a 5 for here. Okay, so both the user 1 and the user 3, they are behaving in the same manner. For item 4, this user 1 is actually giving maybe 5 star. For user 3, you are going to recommend him as 5-star. If he is going to give like maybe, this is the prediction, and the prediction is good, so you are recommending to him, and you are giving to like this guy as a recommendation, but he didn't like it maybe for some reason, and then if he gives like maybe a 1-star actual value, then what we'll be doing, we'll be like giving a penalty, 1-5 the absolute value. So the error is actually 4 for this particular prediction. So it is not like exactly we can predict. You are predicting it as a 5, but he can give 4 also. But you cannot compare whether 4 is equal to 5. That never happens. So you can compare 4-5 the absolute value. So in that case, we can just find the difference measure or distance measure. So recommender system is some kind of like maybe a regression problem where we try to predict the. So sometime you can predict that for user one, the like star is just 1-star. You can just say that it is 1-star. You don't recommend him for any reason. You don't recommend him. You just assume it. You don't recommend him, and then later maybe he gives like 5-star. Then again, there is a error, 1-5, and absolute value will be 4. So it's a kind of like regression matrix. That is our next topic, regression matrix. How do we evaluate the regression problems? So regression problem, we try to predict a real number. A real number, we need to predict it using any model, any logistic regression or polynomial regression or decision tree regression or random forest regression, support vector regression, then neural network regression, and there is like a ridge regression, lasso regression, there is elastic net regression, then there is ADA boost regression, okay, then there is a gradient boosting regression. There are many models. There are many models that can do regression. And all these metrics we have seen till now is actually for classification. For regression, we can actually compute the error. Error is the difference between your Y prediction and the Y true value. So in the recommender systems, just like how we cannot compare 4 equal to 5, in the regression also, we cannot compare, like prediction is 3.8 at the actual value is 4.3. You cannot compare like equal equals. So you compute the difference, which is the like a difference or how likely they are like similar. Okay, so there are two different regression metrics. One is actually error metric, other one is actually a similarity matrix. How much your prediction is similar to the actual, or how much it is different than the actual. So there are some set of measures which are actually the error measures, like mean absolute error, where we take the absolute value and then take the average of all the samples. That is called mean absolute error. So here the thing is like it treats all the errors equally. So maybe if the line is like this, if this is like some samples, so maybe for some sample which is like very, very far, this error is also same and this error is also same. Okay, there is no discrimination in the errors. There is one more called median absolute error, where we like try to take, instead of mean, you try to take the median. So the purpose is like it prevents the outlier from contributing more error to the model. So the same case, you can imagine that maybe the line is like this. Your model was able to like predict almost all the sample and the error is very low. Maybe there is like some sample which is an outlier. But for this sample, your model predicted here. And maybe this line is having a larger length. For rest of the sample, your error is like 0.3, 0.4, something like that. But for this sample, your error is actually maybe 1,000. And adding the 1,000 to this small error and then taking the average, maybe your model error will become like 500 or something. But it should not be the case. Because of this single sample, your model is actually penalized with more error. That is the problem with taking the mean. If there are like outliers in your error, then median absolute error will be helpful. So in the sklearn, this is the function, median absolute error, you can use it. Okay. So similarly, there are other errors also there. So we have like a mean squared error where you try to like take a square between your actual value and the predicted value, take a square and then take the average out of it. So this will give a squared error for a single sample. And it has to be smaller. Okay. And it emphasizes on the larger differences. For example, if there are like some errors which are here very closer, maybe that is a difference of 0.1. If you take a square of 0.1, it will become 0.001. So smaller error will become much more smaller. For example, one large error, difference is 10. 10 square will become 100. So larger error will become more larger. Their effect will be more. Smaller error will become more smaller. So if you want to have a relative penalty, people often choose mean squared error, which is a very, very famous measure again. Okay, so there is a mean squared logarithmic error also, where you can take like maybe log of your predictions and then take a mean squared error. So this will be especially useful if your prediction value is too high. For example, if your prediction, you need to do it in like maybe millions. So in that case, if you just like maybe do a error of like maybe 10,000, taking a 10,000 square will become a big number. Okay, so especially if your data scale is actually very high, then the prediction scale is very high, something like population or maybe like area in square feet, then your mean squared error will become like it will actually explode. So to avoid the explosion, you take a log of the larger value, the predictions. When you take a log, the range of your y will become smaller. In the smaller range, you try to compare to your squared error. Okay, so especially like a population count or average sales, if you want to do that, you can like scale it down and then compute the error. Mean squared logarithmic error. So you can see that it depends upon the application, which error measure that you want to use. There is a max error. Out of all the errors, what is the worst error that your model made? Okay, out of all the error, maybe this is the worst error that your model made. That is a max error. It can give you like what may be the worst error possible by the model. Okay, this is again a like evaluation measure, not a sole evaluation measure, but just an indicator. What will be the worst performance of your model? Okay, so till now we have seen error measure. We are going to now see two similarity measures, which are called the explained variance score. Okay, so the explained variance score will be computed using 1 minus variance of the mistake that you are making divided by the variance of your prediction. Okay, if for example your y minus y cap, if it is like near zero all the time, you are making like good prediction, what will happen? The variance of your error will become near to zero. So zero divided by anything will become zero. So 1 minus 0 will become 1. So for a good model, for a really good model, the explained variance score will be actually near 1, because you have no error. Imagine that maybe the model is actually making too much of mistakes. The error is actually too much. Then what will happen to this number? Variance of your error will become a big number. And it you divide by the like actual data. If the actual data variance is like smaller, but your variance of the error is larger, so it will become like a larger number. So 1 minus a large number will actually become negative. Okay. So if it becomes like a negative, then the model is actually doing a poor performance. So again, larger the better. It should be near zero for a good model. Okay. Lower value, sometime it can go to negative also. That means the model is actually worse. So this is a kind of like a similarity measure for a regression problem. Okay. So the final evaluation measure is actually called the R-square score, or like R2 score, or coefficient of determination. Very often people use it for regression problems. In regression problem, people use like most of the time only two measures. One is mean squared error, other one is the R2 score. Okay. So what happens here? R2 score is actually computed 1 minus y minus y cap whole square. This is the squared error of your model made by the model, divided by y minus y bar. This y bar is actually the mean of your why. So imagine that you are trying to fit a model with just a mean value. What will be the error? And you are trying to fit a model with the data model. What will be the error? And you try to take a division of it. If your model performs really well, then this will be a small number. Then if it becomes a small number, this 1 minus small number may be just 0. Your value will actually become 1. So the maximum value will become 1 for a good model. Imagine that your model is actually not performing well and it is performing very poor than the like a bottom part where your prediction is just a mean value. The whole data you are trying to like fit with just a mean of your data and your model is performing poor than your mean prediction. You know, in those days when we want to predict a particular value, you just take a mean of your value, that is your prediction. So if your model is performing even poorer, very like worse than your mean prediction, then this entire terminology will become a large number. 1 minus large number will actually become negative value or like maybe zero value. So a smaller value of your RSI score is not actually appreciated. That is a poor one. Okay. So these are the different evaluation measures which are there in your regression problems. Okay. For classification, I can summarize. It is accuracy, precision, recall, F measure, and true positive, true negative, false negative, and average precision, mean average precision. And there is one more score also called a die score. Dice score or like, what do you call? Dice coefficient, which is a set similarity measure. And for regression, you have like similarity scores, like variance score, and then the R2 score, and then you have error measure, something like mean absolute error, mean squared error, and then median absolute error, mean squared logarithmic error, and then max error. So you have like other measures, okay? So these are all the things. It is not like a fair to evaluate the model only using one measure. You need to evaluate the model using multiple measures. Okay, so I think with this, we will wind up. So I took like 10 more seconds. Yeah. Okay, great. So any doubts you have, please let me know.
Very nice presentation, Dr. Sridhar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Very, very glad to hear that.
Participants are requested to ask question related to this model evaluation and improvement. No question in chat box. So if anyone is interested, kindly ask, because tomorrow is only one session. Session one will be carried out, will be taken by Dr. Prashant Agnihotri ji. Then thereafter evaluation test will be conducted. And afternoon at 3 p.m. Honorable Vice Chancellor will be chief guest and validatory function will be concluded. So ask question, actually participants are listening properly or not?
Yes, sir, the session was interactive. I had like
okay.
Yeah.
So my question is that what evaluation approaches would you work to gauge the effectiveness of machine learning model?
So it depends upon the problem, sir. If it is a classification, we often go with accuracy and precision recall. And if it is a regression, most often we use mean squared error and R2 score, R-square score.
So for improving the performance, is there any method in this particular performance evaluation?
In the performance evaluation, there is no direct measure, but we need to play with the model. We need to do something called hyper parameter tuning. So this is a little bit broad topic, sir. I have like covered just the evaluation measures and some of the indicators, but there are many methods to improve the accuracy of the model.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Very nice presentation, and you have covered all the aspects of this particular points. And I hope that all the participants have got really enjoyment in the technical topic. And there should be some, you can say, the repercussion, or you can say the reply from all the participants. It should be very interactive.
Yeah.
So anyway, Dr. Partho Rao, please.
Yes.
Proceed.
Yes, sir. So thank you very much, sir. Sridhar, sir, for giving such an interactive knowledge to all the participants. And I have also witnessed that the participants have actively asked questions, and we have actively answered them also. And I hope all the participants are satisfied with the session. Thank you very much, Dr. Sridhar Swaminathan, sir, for giving your valuable time and valuable knowledge to all of us. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Professor Patara and Dr. R. N. Karidi. So thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
I really had a great time. Thank you so much. Thanks to all the participants.
Thank you, sir. So I will now request Mr. Sunil Nayak, sir, to please conclude the session and give a summary of the day's activities. Sunil Nayak, sir, please.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Okay. So the today is the fifth day of the session, and the fifth day of the FTP started with the eminent speaker Dr. D. Lakshmi Padmaja, and the topic of the session was implementing supervised and unsupervised learning models using Python. The speaker started lucidly with the definition of supervised and unsupervised learning, and some of the key points of this session are, so the explanation, first, the explanation was based on supervised and unsupervised learning. Second, machine learning and the types of machine learning. Third, most important technology that is used in machine learning. Fourth, different comparison of algorithm has been done. Fifth, gradient boosting technique purpose has been made. Sixth one, how large your training data set should be. Seventh one is understanding data set and kinds of data set. And the eighth one is installing Python SkyPy libraries, etc. So at the end of the first session, she concluded by making remarks on trained data calculation, and she has given the example of KNN. And the second session started at the time 12:15 to 2 p.m. That is session number 14. So on the same day, session 14 was conducted, and the eminent speaker was Dr. Subed Ali, and the topic was neural networks, training neural networks and testing. The speaker started with basic concepts of neural networks, followed by detailed explanation and examples. And some of the key points of this session are, so first one is explanation of neural network. Second, different machine learning models that is based on classification and regression. Third one is important neural network model and that are used in machine learning. Fourth one, he gave detailed explanation on classification. And sixth one is on classification types, different classification types, started with binary and N array. And the next one is single layer neuron and multilayer neuron. What do you mean by single layer neuron and multilayer neuron? And it is followed by training neural network, loss functions. And finally, he moved on optimization technique, that is gradient descent. And he concluded the methods on back propagation methods. So at the end of the session, he concluded by making remarks on learning weights and bias from data using gradient descent. And the last session on the same day, we are having the session number 15. That is the last session of the day. So on the same day, session 15 was conducted, and the eminent speaker was Dr. Sridhar Swaminathan, and the topic was model evaluation and improvement, cross-validation in Skylet Learn, stratified K-fold cross-validation, evaluation metrics, and scoring. The speaker started with training of model, that is logistic regression, and key points, and some of the key points of this session are, first one, important parameters that are required for training of model in machine learning. Second, why more data is required. Third, data needs to have more diversity. Fourth, algorithm needs longer training. And fifth one is more hidden layers or hidden units are required. Sixth one is add regularization. Seventh one is to change the neural network architecture, like activation function, etc. And the last one is, there are many other considerations you can think of. So the model chosen is based on the precision and recall. Evaluation is based on threshold value, and sample should be taken meticulously. At the end of the session, he concluded by making comments on some of the error rates, mean squared error rate, and R square. So these are all the key points of the today's session, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Naik ji. One announcement that tomorrow, probably our vice chairman, AICT, Professor M.P. Puniyaji will be present as presiding officer. And he will deliver the lecture of presidential lecture on this occasion. And Honorable Vice Chancellor will grace as chief guest on the validatory function. All the participants are requested to kindly be present on time at 3 p.m. And during this validatory function, all successful participants.